Cool. Test 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, how we doing, Goober? Awesome. Okay. So now check the levels, right? Now this, let's say the speaker's here and they're gonna be talking. Hey, my name is blah, blah, blah. I'm here, I'm gonna be doing my thing here and stuff like that. So, let's see where the levels are. You want just a little bit more. Hello, good evening, everyone. Okay, let's go there. And let's, I don't like how this is. Like this is falling down, you know what I mean? It's basically just getting his groin. Okay, this will work. All right. So we're good.
Georgia, Georgia, the whole day through, just an old sweet song keeps that Georgia on my mind, on my mind. I said Georgia, Georgia, song of you comes as sweet and clear as moonlight through the pine. You know it goes deep. Other arms reach out to me. Other eyes smile tenderly. Still in peaceful dreams I see. The road leads back to you. Oh, I, Georgia, Georgia. Oh, peace I find. Just an old sweet song, old sweet song, Georgia on my mind. Oh, just an old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind. There'll always be Georgia. Together, it's you and I. God has made us fall in love, it's true. I've really found someone like you. Will it say the love you feel for me? Will it say that you will be by my side to see me through until my life is through? Can conquer the world in love, you and I, you and I, you. At least in my life, I've found. found someone that may not be here forever to see me through. But I found my strength in you. Cause in my mind, you will stay here always in love. You and I, you and I, you and I, you and I, in my mind, we can conquer the world. By, and I've been holding everything inside, but now I've got nothing left to hide. Well, I'm with you, oh you, but I can't see how strong a man I'm gonna have to be to do for you. It comes so naturally, some of the way you move. There's a chance to prove, show all I can do. I believe in starting over, I can see that your heart is true. I believe in good things coming back to you. You're the light that lifts me higher, so bright to guide me through. I believe in you. Like all the love you get, you don't deserve it. Sometimes I feel my faith is just a burden on you. I believe in starting over, I can see your heart is true. I believe in love, you give me reason to. You're the light that lifts me higher, so high up in the sky. I think we're gonna fly. Starting over, I can see that your heart is true. I believe in love, you give me reason to. You're the light that lifts me higher, so bright you got me through. I believe in you. I believe in you. I believe in you. Whoa, you guide me through. You're a falling star. You're the getaway car. You're the line in the sand when I go too far. You're the swimming pool on an August day. And you're the perfect thing to say. And you play it coy, but it's kinda cute. Oh, when you're smiling at me, you know exactly what you do. Baby, don't pretend that you don't know it's true. Cause you can see it when I look at you. And in this crazy life, and through these crazy times, it's you make me sing your every line, your every word, your everything. You're a carousel, you're a wishing well, and you light me up when you ring my bell. You're a mystery, you're from outer space, you're every minute of my everyday. And I can't believe that I'm your man, and I get to kiss you, baby, just because I can. Whatever comes our way, I will see it through. And you know that's what our love can do. And in this crazy life, and through these crazy times, it's you make me sing your every line, your every word, your everything. Everything, your every song, and I sing along, cause you're my everything. Surrounded by a million people, I still feel all alone. Just wanna go home. Oh, I miss you, you know. And I've been keeping all the letters that I wrote to you, each one a line or two. I'm fine, baby, how are you? I would send them, but I know that it's just not enough. My words were cold and flat, and you deserve more than that. Another aeroplane, another sunny place. I'm lucky, I know, but I wanna go home. I got to go home. Let me go home. I'm just too far from where you are. I wanna come home. Someone else's life. It's like I just stepped outside when everything was going right. And I know just why you could not come along with me. This was not your dream, but you always believed in me. Another winter day has come and gone away in either Paris or Rome, and I wanna go home. Let me go home. And I'm surrounded by a million people. I still feel alone. Let me go home. Oh, I miss you, you know. Let me go home. Let me go home. It'll all be all right. I'll be home tonight. I'm coming back home. Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn. It's a new day, it's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good. Fish in the sea, you know how I feel. River running free, you know how I feel. Blossom on a tree, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good. Dragonfly out in the sun, you know what I mean, don't you know? Butterflies all having fun, you know what I mean. Sleep in peace when day is done, that's what I mean. And this old world is a new world and a bold world for me. Scent of the pine, you know how I feel. Oh, freedom is mine, and I know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life. It's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good. I'm feeling good. I'm feeling so good. I feel so good. Brigade, sing serenade, flying in G6 jets over woodland glade. These are canopies and not hand grenades, and that's a choice we made. Go USA or tap and shoot if you got massive hands or tiny feet. Life hands you lemons, then sell lemonade. It's the choice we made. So I'm gonna sell a soda pop. I'm gonna sell a soda pop. I'm gonna sell a soda pop. Soda, a Yoda, I pop you up. We like the bird. We go likely left, go on strike. We're not scabs. The love we lost when no one stayed, it's the choice we made. They wanna know about clothes we wear, if we swing both ways, and who stays there. As long as we get paid, we don't care that the choice is theirs. So I wanna sell a soda pop. I'm gonna sell a soda pop. I wanna sell a soda pop. Soda, Yoda, about you up. Come enjoy the medley. How you dance through the fire, it's all that matters now. Can you resist us? We are the business, so.
Thank you.
a lover. I'll do anything you ask me to. And if you want another kind of love, I'll wear a mask for you. And if you want a partner, take my hand. And if you want to strike me down in anger, here I stand. I'm your man. And if you want a boxer, I will step into the ring for you. And if you want a doctor, I'll examine every inch of you. And if you want a father for your child, I only want to walk with me across the sand. Well, I'm your man. The moon's too bright, the chain's too tight, the beast won't go to sleep. I've been reading through these promises to you that I made and could not keep. Oh, but a man never got a woman back, not by begging her at his knees. I thought you'd be a baby, and I'd call it your feet. I'd howl at your beauty like a dog in heat. And I'd crawl at your heart, and I'd tear at your sheet. I said, please, 'cause I'm a gentleman. Cause I'm your man. My motivation to put on separate teams. Maybe I found someone I really need. Well, baby, you're with it, and I'm not impervious to what you do to me. You help me find my sense of urgency. And time flies, I wish I would have met with someone psychic. 'Cause my, it took some time for me to realize it. 'Cause today, tomorrow, why take any longer? The feeling's getting stronger. No, I can't wait. I can't wait anymore. 'Cause today is yesterday's tomorrow. I am Nostradamus, but the future is upon us. No, I can't wait. I can't wait anymore. Anymore, yeah. I know that you're hoping that this is the notebook, but baby, it's you. See, Mr. Gosling ain't got nothing on me. Like Owen Alley when Harry met Sally, we knew that this had to be the kind of love that lasts eternally. And I know that some will say that it could end in heartache. But, my dear, you only fear the chances that we don't take. Yesterday's tomorrow, why I take any longer? The feeling's getting stronger. No, I can't wait. I can't wait anymore. 'Cause today is yesterday's tomorrow. I am Nostradamus, but the future is in front of us. No, I can't wait. I can't wait anymore. Fast, yeah. Today is a yesterday's tomorrow. Why I take any longer? The feeling's getting stronger. I can't wait anymore. 'Cause today is a yesterday's tomorrow. Someday, when I'm awfully low, when the world is cold, I will feel a glow just thinking of you and the way you look tonight. You're lovely with your smile so warm and your cheeks so soft. There is nothing for me but to love you and the way you look tonight. With each word, your tenderness grows, tearing my fears apart. And that laugh that wrinkles your nose, it touches my foolish heart. Never ever change. Keep that breathless charm. Won't you please arrange it? 'Cause I love you just the way you look tonight. I can hear her heartbeat for a thousand miles, and the heavens open up every time she smiles. And when I come to her, that's just where I belong. Yet I'm running to her like a river song. She gives me love, 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 crazy love. Gives me love, 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 crazy love. She's got a fine sense of humor when I'm feeling low down. And when I come to her, when the sun goes down, she takes away my trouble, takes away my grief, takes away all of my heartache in the night like a thief. She give me love, 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 crazy love. She give me love, 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 crazy love. Crazy love. She gives me love, 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 crazy love. Yes, I need her in the daytime. Oh, but I need her in the night. Yes, I wanna throw my arms around her, kiss her hug good time. And when I'm returning from so far away, she give me some sweet loving, brighten up my day. Yes, it makes me righteous, it makes me feel whole, and it makes me mellow down to my soul. She gives me love, 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 crazy love. She gives me love. Seeing that smile, it's been such a long time. And although I don't have you, I know now that I need to somehow make you mine. I won't lie, touching you with him, 'cause I know he can hold you like I can. Someday, I won't give my love away, darling, I'm forever Someday maybe I'll be yours.
Start by me feeding them.
Oh yeah,
some
so
questions.
I also I have those just in case.
Yeah, I read those.
But really,
and he's from
really just
don't you know each cloud contains and he's from
yeah.
You'll find your fortune falling all over the town. Be sure that your umbrella is upside down.
And when are we, you know, it's like 8:35 now.
Package of sunshine and some flowers. If you want the things you love, you must have showers.
If we could,
so when
we could find our seats. If I could encourage you to find your seat, grab your copy. Well, I want to thank everyone for coming here to the University of California Irvine for our conference this morning. We have quite a few people online that were expecting this to start at 8:30, so we want to make sure they don't drop off. So we want to get this started. So I want to welcome all of you here today. I certainly want to thank UCI, Alberto Sandoval and team. Thank you for allowing us to rent your facilities at a reasonable price. I also want to thank the Association of California Cities, Orange County, who've been real helpful in assisting. We also have a number of elected officials here today that I'd like to recognize, at least those that I'm aware of. We have the Honorable Patrick Brindon, newly elected. Have you been installed yet?
Monday.
Council member-elect from the city of Huntington Beach. We have the incoming mayor for Huntington Beach, Barbara Del Gleese, is here today. I think David Harrington was coming this morning. I haven't seen him yet. And Dave Sullivan from Huntington Beach was going to be here as well. I see some former council members as well. We also have Glenn Rockmore, the president of Irvine Valley College. So it's good to have Glenn here today as well. And are there any other electeds that I did not have on my list? I know we have former, but we're just going to go with current. Sorry. So with that, we get a lot of calls as a state senator, and get a lot of feedback from people like, what's happening at our shopping center? How come there's more security guards? What might be going on in California that maybe we should be looking at? And I know when I was a county supervisor, I had the privilege for about 7 of the 8 years to serve as the chairman of the Orange County Criminal Justice Coordinating Committee. And we got to work with the sheriff's department and the district attorney, the chief of probation, the presiding judges. We work with healthcare. We work with our Office of Independent Review. And we all worked together and struggled with what was known as AB 109. How do we deal with all these inmates that are coming down into Orange County because the governor of California has to reduce a population in our state's prisons? So it's been kind of interesting to see what's sort of been occurring in our county, but also around the state. And so we've had 2 years now since Prop 47 passed successfully, a ballot measure that was approved by a good percent of the voters, with a unique ballot title, with unique terms like you gotta send the savings somewhere, and I, as an accountant, I'm trying to figure that one out still to this day. And so now we can look back and say, what are we seeing? And now with Prop 57 just passing last month, you know, what may that do to what's happening in our state? So when you have a lot of cities that are calling and saying, hey, what's going on? It was our idea then to put a conference together. Let's get educated. Let's debate. Let's listen to both sides. And let's see what may come out of this that maybe we can pursue in this upcoming legislative year or the following one. So with that, I am really excited to introduce our moderator. No, I have to start this off a little differently. I get to introduce the Honorable Barbara Delglees, and we will have her do the Pledge of Allegiance. And it's an honor to have you here, Barbara. And I, we could all rise. And then
good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. I'm sure many of you yesterday remember December 7th. And one of the things that we did in our city of Huntington Beach is we did have a memorial. But more than that, I think rites of passages are so very, very important to celebrate and to remember. And so I'm honored today to lead in the Pledge of Allegiance, but think of this really as many of you get to do this every day if you're in a classroom or a meeting or something of that sort, but it never gets old. So together, join me please in this beautiful rite of passage that we have as Americans. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you.
I had the pleasure of being appointed to the Sesquicentennial Foundation back in 1995 and enjoyed California's history and had the pleasure of working with State Librarian Kevin Starr. Dr. Starr is a well-known author on California history, and it was a real treat. And so now that I'm up in Sacramento, I've really gotten to enjoy and appreciate our current State Librarian, Greg Lucas, who I guess I would say, as a younger person, I'd say he's a real kick in the head. He's just a lot of fun. So I'll say a few things about his bio. He was appointed state librarian by Governor Brown on March 25, 2014. Prior to that, he was the senior editor for Capital Weekly from 2011 to 2014. He's written and edited California's Capital, a website he created in 07, focused on California history and politics. He was Sacramento Bureau Chief and a Capital reporter for the San Francisco Chronicle from 88 to 07. He covered the Capitol for the Los Angeles Daily Journal from 85 to 88. And he has a master's degree in professional writing from the University of Southern California and a bachelor's in communications from Stanford University. And so I am really honored, Greg, that you could come down and visit one of your 58 counties and enjoy some time with us this morning. So please give Greg a real warm welcome.
Sound of Music. It's like the family Von Trapp. There's nobody here at the table. Wait, gotta turn this on. So why doesn't our first panel come up and I'll introduce them? Have I turned this
on? Yeah. Successfully? Yeah. Okay.
Now I must say I don't see my cousin Scott Kernan, the head of the correctional department. And so, Scotty, as he's known, my wife's mother's brother is Scott's dad. And so it's kind of funny. I'll be sitting in the office and somebody will talk about something that has to do with the state prison system. And I'll say, well, I mean, do you want me to call Scotty or what? And, his mom, Scott, who's not here, of course, but he was the warden of Mule Creek Prison, which is near Sacramento in Ione. And so was his mom, Peggy, who was the first woman warden on death row at San Quentin. So it's in the family. But let me start. I can't see. I think I know you from Googling you all, but let me just introduce Magnus. I know Magnus Lofstrom is a senior fellow at the Public Policy Institute of California, and lucky for us today, his areas of expertise are public safety, immigration, entrepreneurship, and education, and his recent work has been on crime trends in California, public safety, realignment, and recidivism. And I'll probably be picking on you first before we begin, or when we begin. And Marissa Arona from Californians for Safety and Justice previously came from New Orleans, I want to say, where she worked with the mayor on an initiative of his, I'm going to blank on the name now, but to reduce the number of homicides in the city. And now is with the Californians for Safety and Justice coordinating sort of Proposition 47 issues. Is that fair? Okay. Thank you for being here with us. And let's see, Chris
Bieber
is the chief deputy
probation officer
for the county of Orange.
Correct.
And you know, it's hard to find a biography of you on the internet.
I was going to say, if you Googled me, you probably had a few hits before.
But there's some awesome photos. There's some awesome photos of you holding resolutions.
Yeah.
Right. With. So briefly, Chris has oversight of the Field Operations Bureau, including the post-release community supervision division, and has been with the department for over 30 years and served in multiple assignments ranging from juvenile institutions, field supervision, youth and family resource center, and gang violence suppression. And rounding out our panel is Irvine's police chief, Mike Hamill, who's a 23-year law enforcement veteran. Began briefly with the LA Police Department and then transferred to Irvine like 20-something years
95.
Ago. Right, and been the chief since 20?
1 year.
Well, yeah, right. So almost just over a year, right? Just so last year. November.
That's
yeah.
Correct.
Yeah. Well, anyway, so we're going to talk a little bit about Prop 47 and its impact on the state of California. And so you heard Senator Moorlach talking about The structure of the initiative is a little bit different than some past public safety initiatives. And actually one of the better things I've read about it was a report done by the Public Policy Institute of California, which begins by saying that I'm gonna get it wrong, but you can correct me. But it says that the dividends haven't yet been realized from the savings that Prop 47 contemplates going into greater it's health counseling and rehabilitative services. So can you tell us a little bit about that report? And somebody will certainly ask when the dividends will start to come in. So
I mean, we've seen a number of measures, criminal justice reforms and changes in California going back to about 2009 when we were facing a federal court order to reduce the prison population quite dramatically. In 2009, it meant that we had to reduce the prison population by about 40,000. Measures were introduced by CDCR. We talked already, we mentioned a realignment in 2011. That dramatically reduced the prison population, changed parole as well, reduced the number of parolees, shifted that responsibility to good folks like Chris, to probation. And when we think about savings, we saw these big reductions. We've seen a drop in the prison population since 2009 of almost 41,000, 42,000. You know, big changes. You'd expect maybe we're going to see savings from that, but we haven't seen that yet in terms of the fiscal. We spend at historic amounts on our corrections budget in California. We're at about $10.6 billion. So we haven't seen those savings yet. And I think,
Is that still more than what we spend on higher education?
No, it's not. Okay. It's not. But it doesn't take into account the $1.3 billion that are sent down to the counties to pay for realignment. So it's a historic high. We've never spent that much money on corrections in California. We've seen big increases. The share of the general funds that goes towards corrections has tripled since the 1980s. So we see those big increases in our spending on corrections. No doubt about that. Savings are hard to come by. Part of it is it's a prison system that was being sued and needed to improve medical and mental health care to the inmate population. Difficult to do, costly to do. And then the fact that with the pressure on the system, you can't really close a prison system. In fact, we've had to rent beds elsewhere. So we haven't seen that. When it comes to Prop 47 and those savings, it was also expected that it was going to lead to significant savings that were going to be redirected down towards the counties. But we've seen, obviously, some, and I'm sure we'll get some details about it, but it hasn't been quite the amount that we've seen. And I think that there are two big factors that determines whether or why we haven't seen those specific factors. One is how many inmates in CDCR are actually not being incarcerated as a result of Prop 47. And the state came up with a number of a little bit over 5,000. Whether that is the correct number or not, I'm not entirely sure. We saw a drop in the first year since the passing of Prop 47 of about 9,000. There were other measures the CDCR had to implement in that period of time that accounts for some of that, but it's striking, 9,000. The year before, the prison population went up by 2,000. So part of it is that number. It might not be as much as we'd expected. And the other part is, how do you count those savings? Is it, you know, what is that amount that we should assign to each inmate who's no longer incarcerated? And I think many of us expect that number to be a little bit higher. So that I think, is a long way of getting the answer to that question.
Before we go on, what I forgot to do as a housekeeping thing is under your chairs, there's comment cards with pens. If you have questions, write them down. We'll collect them. They're bound to be more penetrating and thoughtful than anything I can come up with. So please make sure you do that, and we'll have time for them. Folks will come, just hold them up and people will come and collect them. Sorry.
Thank you. If I could
add on the savings issue. So what's really interesting about Prop 47, as everyone is talking about here, is the reallocation component. Now, there are 23 other states in the country that have done something similar to Prop 47. They've changed the threshold on what constitutes a felony. And data in those states have shown no impact on crime. You have to wait for about 3 years after a reform takes place. But none of those other states included a reallocation component where the savings, once identified, go 65% into mental health and substance abuse treatment, into victim services and programs for at-risk youth. It's very hard to identify savings. And I work very closely in LA County with the Board of Supervisors, with the Sheriff's Office, with two Prop 47 task forces that have been tasked to do just that, for the county agencies to identify, at least on the county level, savings and departments impacted by Prop 47. Now, two things make this very hard to do. The agencies don't use uniform and consistent data collecting and reporting. So agencies do not speak to each other. And really, our criminal justice system is a series of silos working, sort of one at a time. Someone gets arrested, what's the impact there at booking, et cetera, et cetera. But what is found often is system efficiencies. And it's while there may not be a dollar value, at least in LA County, and hopefully this can be a model for other counties, is to see where those efficiencies are and make the system more efficient and then get to a savings realization.
Yeah. I'd like to come back to that in a little while, but can we talk a little bit about, so in Sacramento, right, everything at best is at 20,000 feet up looking down, and I'm wondering, so what's happening in your probation department as a result of 47?
Yes, thank you for that. I'm gonna back up a little bit. We mentioned Assembly Bill 109.
And do they all know about
this table may have heard about AB 109. Back in 2011, that crested upon us here, and from the Orange County Probation's Department's perspective, since AB 109, we have received just under 10,000 individuals, both from the state, about 6,300 from the state that would have been on parole, that are under our supervision, under post-release community supervision, and a little under 3,500 individuals that have been placed on mandatory supervision, yet another form of local supervision, not probation, but very similar to probation. So again, about 10,000 individuals since Assembly Bill 109 has passed have come through Orange County. As a result of Prop 47, the courts have reduced sentences and placed individuals on misdemeanor probation to the tune of a little over 4,000 individuals. So
I mean, there's been a spike.
There was a spike from AB 109, and as a result, our caseloads in the probation department rose significantly. Even though there was money from AB 109 funneled to, Senator Moorlach remembers his time that it was a very difficult time, and we were actually under a hard hiring freeze at the county. So even though we were receiving these individuals in, we couldn't expand at the time. So over the subsequent years, we were able to expand and catch our breath after Prop 47. So our caseloads were, our average caseloads in our adult generic supervision were over 110 individuals, which is not ideal. You're more, when you're a probation officer with that type of caseload, you're more reactive than being proactive. Since Prop 47, we've lost some of those cases. Our caseloads are down to more manageable levels, around 70 or so for our generic field supervision. So we're able to do more with those cases. And I'll get into it perhaps a little bit later about our offenders have changed.
Go for it.
Okay, well, we used to supervise the drug offender that Prop 47 impacted, and the model or the profile is that they are nonviolent, and thus now they're subverted from the system. 109 gave us a different individual, gave us the individuals from released from state prison. So the individuals that were on for personal crimes against person
back in 2014, correction, back in 2011, before Assembly Bill 109, 19% of the individuals that we supervised on probation were on for crimes of the person. And in fact, almost half, 48% of the individuals supervised locally were on for drugs, whether that's possession or sales, mostly possession. Fast forward to now, today, 32% of the individuals that are supervised locally are on for crimes against persons, and only 24% of the individuals that are under supervision are on for drug-related crimes, mostly sales. What we have not seen is the court's propensity to revert the misdemeanor probations, the misdemeanor probation, misdemeanor offenses into formal probation. The vast, vast majority of individuals have been placed on misdemeanor probation and placed on informal court probation, so we don't see them anymore. Thus, over 4,000 cases have left the department. So it's changed. It's changed the individuals that we supervise. I think what's important, though, is to focus on, and I'm glad that we're having the discussion about the funds, because it's been almost 2 years, and it's critical that we establish the safety net, if you will, for these individuals that that are in need. Maybe preaching to the choir, but we don't know. We can't make an individual, a drug offender, stop being a drug offender. We can't force them. But we also don't know when that aha moment might be realized by an offender. So we need to have these programs in place when they decide that it's time to seek treatment. And without formal supervision to kind of nudge and prod an individual towards treatment, we've kind of lost the ability to steer them in the right direction. So we're very much looking forward to the money coming back from the state to establish transitional programs, as well as residential treatment for the individuals when they do make that decision to seek treatment.
Yeah, well, let's come back to that. But Chief, how does all this affect what you do?
Sure, thanks very much. So I represent also not only Irvine PD, but speaking on behalf of Cal Chiefs. Cal Chiefs is the organization that is the voice of all municipal police chiefs. And we've done a lot of tracking of crime data since the passage of Prop 47. And one thing that's interesting to note is, after nearly two decades of decrease in FBI Part 1 crime, both violent crime and property crime, across the entire nation, in 2015, both California and the rest of non-California states saw a small increase in violent crime. But really, the story is the property crime. And if you look at just California, the increase in property crime in California was about just over 7%, while if you look at other non-California cities in the nation, they actually witnessed a continued decrease in property crime of just over 4%, almost 5%. So if you were to do a trend forecast, the rate change in property crime for the non-California states is about, it's within the range, but the rate change, the increase in property crime in California, again, of about 7%, that's outside any kind of trend forecast that we'd expect. So the question becomes, you know, what is causing that? There has to be something that's causing that. And, you know, we're not aware, Cal Chiefs as an organization, of any other major policy change that could possibly be responsible for that increase. That being said, I understand that you know, when you look at trying to figure out what's causing increase in crime, there's a lot of factors that could impact that. It's a complex problem, but from our perspective, it does appear that Prop 47 is having an impact on crime. I'll share a couple of things to follow up on the comments that Chief Probation Officer made. A couple of just examples. So when we're talking about offenders and, you know, and what kind of treatment programs, because I would agree that, you know, that ideally if you have a drug offender, you want them to be in a drug treatment program. You want to try to get them to the place where they no longer are dependent. What we're seeing is in Irvine, I know this is true for most California cities, there is a strong correlation between someone who's arrested for drugs and someone who's arrested for a theft-related crime. In the vast majority of cases, when we arrest somebody for drug possession, they also often have stolen property in their possession. Conversely, arrest somebody for a theft-related offense, they often are high or they have drugs in their possession. Couple of case studies, and again, these are from Irvine. I changed the names just for the sake of confidentiality. We had a case I'll call him Gary. He is a young adult, and he was arrested in Irvine. This is just 14 times in the past 6 months, and these arrests predominantly were for drug offenses, also for assault, disorderly conduct, theft, burglary, 14 times in 6 months. And on November 23rd, just before Thanksgiving, he was arrested twice in the same day for a misdemeanor warrant, and then later that day for petty theft from a vehicle. And you know, prior to Prop 47, there would have been an incentive for this person to perhaps go into drug court to get treatment. Now there's no incentive. It's a ticket, and the person's out the door. Another example, this is a 31-year-old male, we'll call him Paul, arrested. He's been arrested 17 times in Irvine since November of 2014. His arrests are predominantly related to drugs, possession of heroin under the influence. I could give some more examples, but those are the things we're seeing at the local level. I can tell you too, I mentioned that the increase in the average increase in California in property crime was over 7%. In Orange County, it was 20%. In Irvine, it was 26%.
But Marissa, you look like you wanted to jump in there.
If I could, please. So thank you, Chief. This issue of chronic offenders is really important, and I've worked in Oakland, New Orleans, back in California, and in many cities, enforcement DAs will know who the top 200, 250 most chronic offenders are by name, and maybe by history as well, as do the officers on the street. And so what that really points out, and many people know this who work in law enforcement, there's generally a small percentage of individuals that cause a huge percentage of offenses and really problems in the community. So focused deterrence programs are very important. What's important to note here is that, and I've seen data in LA County, Prop 47, individuals who are arrested for Prop 47 offenses, about half of them, just under half, are rearrested for some offense, which means about half are not rearrested for some other offense. Of the ones who are arrested for a subsequent offense, it's generally simple drug possession, which really highlights the need to really prioritize addiction, treatment for addiction, for substance abuse issues, mental health disorders, and really focus resources on the small percentage of individuals who take up so many critical resources. So I just sort of wanted to point that out. These anecdotes are very important to know, and generally you know who those individuals are, and it helps to focus resources through targeted deterrence. LEAD, Law Enforcement Assisted Diversion, is one such program. There's now funding in the state budget for some pilot programs across the state, and really an opportunity for local communities to get innovative on how they address the drivers of low-level crime.
Yeah, so you guys help me on this. I used to know these statistics when I was a reporter, but there's a high percentage of you know, criminals or inmates in state prison, right, who have addiction issues. Is it, what's the number you guys use, 70% higher, lower? I mean, there's literacy issues, and that's about 70% of folks behind bars don't read, have literacy skills. I mean, what do you guys operate under as a, I mean, you were talking about the need. I mean, how many people need that? Do we know?
Well, I don't know that it's a majority of people in custody. There are mental health issues. We're seeing that increase.
That's a lot of dual diagnosis.
Dual diagnosis,
right.
Substance abuse issues. What's interesting is in San Diego, the city attorney just launched the SMART program for misdemeanors, chronic misdemeanors. And even before reallocation comes down, they've partnered, and this is really critical, is this cross-agency collaboration, getting out of those silos and partnering with service providers and law enforcement and DAs for diversion to treatment beds. They also have a community justice initiative where chronic individuals who commit chronic crime are diverted to community service at a treatment provider. So they're not being, they don't have to enroll, they just can go work in the office or work on the landscaping at a treatment provider. Many of those individuals, after their 60 days or however many hours are assigned, after they've completed that assignment, will stay and take advantage of that treatment. So it's really about this opportunity for innovation and creativity, and most important, this cross-sector collaboration that needs to occur to address truly the low-level drivers of crime. You can, you're right that someone would have had the incentive, you know, pre-Prop 47, perhaps, to enroll in a drug court or enforcement. We don't know what the statistics are. What really were the numbers before Prop 47? Was there not this revolving door in the criminal justice system of people just cycling in and out and chronic offenders? So there's definitely this data, this need for a deeper dive into the data and what it means.
I mean, is there, Chris, like there's a shortage of beds relative to the need? I mean, that continues, right?
Yes. I'd like to address very quickly the drug court.
Sure.
And this speaks of the program in a very positive light. When Prop 47 passed, the individuals that were enrolled in our drug courts, the vast majority of them stayed in the drug court, despite the ability for them to leave drug court with very, very few sanctions. What we're seeing, and if you're not familiar with drug court, it is a national model that treats individuals differently and has a very high success rate with regards to recidivism. In fact, 68% of the individuals that graduate from drug court are felony free for 3 years after their graduation. And if you've seen state statistics, that's very impressive. What we're seeing, though, is the individuals are not joining drug court at the percentage that traditionally you had, because we don't have the, and I'll use the analogy carrot and stick, the ability to incentivize someone into drug court while also using probation and law enforcement to keep them on the right track and incarcerate them for shorter periods of time, which is the drug court model, introduce different sanctions, interim sanctions before incarceration. Also in Orange County, we have 5 mental health courts, and I bring that up because mental health and the drug problem are intertwined. And in fact, and I think Under Sheriff Barnes may allude to this in the next panel, that 2/3 of the individuals that are in custody with mental health issues have co-occurring disorders that also have alcohol and drug addiction. So when we're talking about drug addiction, we're also talking about mental health issues, and it's critical that we not forget that. And I believe that 65% of the monies that are supposed to spin back around are for mental health treatment as well as drug. So I just want to address that the drug courts are suffering a bit. We met with the judge of the collaborative court, and we're in discussions to open that door a little bit wider to allow individuals that previously we wouldn't have considered in drug court. Again, I referred earlier to the different type of client that we have, and that is apparent also in our drug courts. So we're discussing, and in fact have allowed some individuals that are convicted of drug sales into our drug courts. Now, those individuals are vetted stringently by our department, and the individuals that are convicted of drug sales, however, the nexus for their sales is their abuse. That is the initial problem, significant issue with them. Those individuals have been allowed into drug court. We're also allowing individuals that have violence in their history. So we're talking about a different track for drug court. Mm-hmm.
where we can also address the individuals, the traditional drug offenders, but also bring in individuals that we previously hadn't before that can take part in a program that has shown significant improvements in recidivism rates.
So Magnus, I had a question for you. So when is the state going to find the savings? I'm asking it carefully because these are the same people that appointed me, so but just in the interest of full disclosure. Right.
Well, if we look at the corrections budget and the ways that we could see some savings there.
Can I ask it a different way? So what does Proposition 47 say is supposed to happen? Right, so there's a savings that's supposed to be generated by...
There's a saving supposed to be generated by fewer offenders being incarcerated in state facilities, state prisons, at CDCR. And the savings that comes from that specific change will be redirected towards the counties. There are savings that will take place at the county level as well through the decrease in the jail populations, something that we've seen a drop. If we look at the first year of Prop 47, the county jail population dropped by about 9,000. So the counties are experiencing some savings from that particular change itself. But coming back to the state, if we're going to try to slow the growth in correction spending and maybe actually get a decrease, it seems like the only way to do that is to reduce the inflow into our state prison system. We have to reduce the prison population to the level of either we stop renting beds within California or outside of California. There are about 8,000 inmates that are housed on contracts. They're not in state facilities. That would lead to significant savings if we went that route, if we could reduce that. Or it's that we can reduce the prison population to the level of where we can close a state prison. And those are the only ways that we're probably going to see significant savings. And it's challenging. Prop 47 did undoubtedly reduce the prison population. We saw that drop in the first year, but it's gone up again. It's up since February of this year. The prison population is up by about 1,900. It grows by about 200 per month. And the challenge here is not just to close down the prison population and house these inmates somewhere else, because we have that federal court order hanging over our shoulders that we have to keep the prison population at 137.5% of design capacity.
Which is what? How many people is that?
It's in our CDCR institutions, that's about 110,000, 111,000.
Plus the leased beds?
Plus the leased beds, but that doesn't count into the design capacity part of it. That's a way that you relieve pressure from the system. So that creates some challenges there, some serious challenges in order to get savings for the state, no doubt about it.
Chief, you were trying to jump in?
Sure, just to respond to that. So. As far as the savings are concerned, and just citing from a report in February 2015 from the state's legislative analyst office, it claimed that there could be a possible savings from 100 to 200 million beginning in the 2016-17 fiscal year. Now, I don't know if those savings have actually been realized or not, but I think you have to also look at the costs and how the costs can offset the savings. And according to the DOJ, the value of stolen property in 2015 was about $2.4 billion, which represented an increase of about $287.8 million, or 13%, over 2014. And this was the largest year-over-year increase in the past 10 years. And in fact, we had not seen the value of stolen property so high since 2008. And of course, that doesn't even consider the you know, emotional costs, the costs that you can't measure to victims. Who, you know, I'm sure if you've ever had your car broken into or your home broken into, that there is a sense of loss and violation that occurs in that, and so there's other costs that are hard to really articulate or measure, I should say. So when we're talking about savings, you have to also look at the potential costs as well and how that may offset the savings.
Can we we just go back to some, so forgive my ignorance, but have you seen any of the potential savings of $200 million? I mean, the check isn't coming, right? We're in the 26,
so the reallocation,
17 fiscal year.
Well, the reallocation process starts early next year. There has been $68 million identified in the state budget. There was an executive steering committee that put together the RFP that was just recently issued. And what's interesting about the RFP process, it's not like AB 109 where funds will be allocated proportionally to each county. It's a competitive grant process. So counties that have sort of aligned, lined up to get competitive in that process, counties that have started this cross-agency collaboration, these partnerships that are trying innovative programs. In San Diego, they used existing funds for the SMART program and have leveraged that into DOJ funds. So these innovations can begin before the reallocation process begins, but the RFPs have been issued. Counties are getting together. I get all of the announcements of the advisory committees coming together in each county to prepare that RFP, and I think grant funds will begin to be awarded early next year, maybe February. But it's important to note this discussion about funding is the most important takeaway is we really need to prevent crime, right? So for years, we've been functioning on this premise of, well, we just address crime after it happens. After the car has been broken into, how many of those cases are cleared? After the purse snatching has occurred, what are the clearance rate on those cases to begin with? We have to really look at how do we prevent that crime from happening? What are those the drivers of that crime? Is it homelessness? Is it poverty? Is it drug addiction? Do we have funds now to be innovative and partner with agencies to start addressing that? And then be in this competitive position for the reallocation process and then leverage that for DOJ funds. So there's much to do even before that reallocation starts coming down.
Is this where I say we should invest more in literacy? Yeah, okay. But
absolutely.
I'm sorry, you were leaning forward towards
I was just going to agree with that you know, we of course we're debating the impact of Prop 47 and looking, you know, backwards, but the most important thing really is I think we can all agree that all of us on the panel, we may be on different paths, but we all want the same goal, and that is safer communities. And so this is part of that process, are these kinds of discussions.
I mean, relative to, 2 years in, in government, certainly state government, it's kind of early in the ballgame, right?
Well, depends on what perspective you come from.
Politics, they say where you stand depends on where you sit.
Right.
So.
Well, it's if you're talking about crime, it's their victims there, and then it's not a, you know, it's you get a little bit concerned when you see these things happening. But I think from an evaluation perspective, we're getting to the point now where we can start to say something about Prop 47. The data is starting to come together, that it can be analyzed and we can get a better picture of how Prop 47 is affecting all these different things that we're talking about here. And at that point, there's no doubt that crime went up in 2015. We've seen that violent crime did go up, but as the chief pointed out, that's something that's happening in a number of other states as well. The increase, there were 39 other states that saw increases in violent crime in 2015, so we're not alone there. Our increase was a little bit more than we saw in the rest of the country, so don't brush that under the rug. We need to understand what's behind it. There's no doubt about that. But it seems like that's not probably not driven by Prop 47. It certainly needs further analysis. But if we look at the property crime, it's up. It's close to 7%, depending on if you look at the FBI or the DOJ numbers, how they're reported. But say around 7% increase in the property crime. There we stand out a little bit more. There were only 8 other states that saw increases. And the question now is, what did Prop 47 play any role? And if so, to what extent? And bottom line is still, even when we can answer that question, is what are the strategies to deal with public safety here? We are making a lot of changes in California. We have a number of criminal justice reforms passed in the last 6-7 years. And certainly one common theme of these is that it's reducing our reliance on incarceration. That by itself might put upward pressure on crime trends, but the question is, what do we do then to counter these other changes? We need to figure out what are the right strategies, and we've talked about some of them here. There's one thing that I think that we haven't talked about that's important, and a big change that's happened since the Great Recession that's fiscally driven, and that's that there's been a drop in the number of law enforcement officers in California. There is, since the Great Recession, if we measure this by, you know, number of law enforcement officers per 100,000 residents, it's down by about 10%. You know, this is at a time when these local criminal justice actors have more responsibilities because of the reforms we're passing. We need to keep that in mind as well as we're moving forward. That's one of the strategies to look at and how it can be done well and what are the challenges these local community agencies are facing. I mean, part of it might be a recruitment problem, it's training, everything else, but it's we need to think about that part as well.
2 points. One is, absolutely, we need to be thoughtful about how we and the programs that we develop here. Say what you want about how 109 impacted the county and the state. The positive impact of AB 109 was that we learned as a county how to collaborate, and it forced us to all get together. And in my 30 years of working with the county, our collaborative relationships with regards to the stakeholders in the criminal justice system has never been stronger. The community-based organizations are at the table at all our discussions, and reference the competitive bid process for the Prop 47 funds. We've already had conversations about how we're going to approach that, and we expect to be competitive in that process. The other thing is, and Marissa mentioned, how we the key to this is to keep people from committing crime. So we in the probation department have employed what we call cognitive behavioral therapy, and that's a relatively new trend. The old days, and I was an officer with a caseload, and I sat across a desk and I pointed my finger at somebody and I said, don't do it. And of course they did, because they were addicts and that's what addicts do. These days, all of our officers are trained in what we call EPICS, Effective Practices in Community Supervision, and it's just a different way of conducting an office interview. Instead of wagging a finger at somebody, it's asking open-ended questions. These interviews are videotaped, and they are reviewed by professionals that teach EPICS, and there's a back and forth dialogue between both the offender and the probation officer, and we're just starting these programs, so it's a different way of dealing with offenders. We're also teaching cognitive behavioral therapy in the form of Thinking for a Change, and a program called Decision Points. And there's different names for these types of programs, but it's essentially approaching the offender from a different perspective, and it's some of the things that we need to expand upon. And as I mentioned, our caseloads are becoming more manageable. We're able to do more with the offenders that we have, but you know, probation sits in the middle. These individuals have already shown a propensity to commit felonies, so we're always balancing community safety with offender resocialization. So those are some of the things that we're trying to do.
So in your conversations, right, over what to do in the RFP, what do you see as the highest, I mean, what do you need that you don't have now? And I guess I'd ask Chief Campbell the same thing.
Right.
And what's missing?
Right, I would say, a viable reentry program, additional residential treatment, interim housing for the individuals. What we're discussing now is actually something that the Sheriff's Department had an entire plan for, transition from jail to community, years ago when the recession hit, and those plans had to be shelved. We're talking about treatment inside the facilities, and also a 24-hour facility where individuals that are released from jail show up. We can introduce them to the whatever their needs may be, whether that's interim housing, transportation, to probation. As it stands now, the individuals are released, you know, in the middle of the night from jail, and they, for the most part, have lost the traction that they had in the community. And what do? They call individuals that they're most familiar with and generally get back on the wrong track. So one of the large needs in our county is to have a collaborative, rehabilitative reentry program, but also the individuals that we don't see that Chief Hamill's officers are coming in contact with that are not under formal supervision. Right now, I don't want to speak for you, but I'm safe in saying that there's not a lot of options for the officers on the street. It's either a cite and release, or perhaps they bring them back to the station and book them for a while, and I'm sure you want to comment on that. But if there was a third option where the officers were able to take these individuals to a detox center where they could start treatment. Now, it would have to be voluntary, but, you know, if you catch somebody at the right time, as I mentioned before, you have to have those safety net in place. So in my estimation, those are some of the more glaring needs that we have here in Orange County.
I would echo everything that Chris said. If you look at, say, mental health, for instance, in Irvine, the number of calls that have a link or nexus to mental health have increased drastically over the past couple of years. Really, just to mirror what he said, I do think that better support, mental health services, and also true programs for drug treatment, because, I mean, the reality is that drug arrests in Irvine in the past year went up about 400 or so, from about 600 to over about 1,000 or so. And that was a drastic increase. And he's right. I mean, we try our very best to collaborate with other agencies, social services, sometimes nonprofits like National Alliance of Mental Illness. And we have made some headway. And what we're seeing now is contemporary law enforcement agencies are doing a lot more social work type non-traditional activities than they ever have before, because oftentimes law enforcement officers, we really are the front lines in dealing with some of these pressing social issues like homelessness, mental health, and drug abuse, which all go hand in hand, as we've heard from the panel members. So in Irvine, we've been blessed in terms of having a great support from the council and the city manager as far as having enough officers and personnel to do the job. But then it's just a matter of how then do we further collaborate so we can really have true, meaningful wraparound services that can help people. Because I can say honestly, and I can speak for police chiefs, that we want to see people rehabilitated as much as anybody else. But sometimes there is a level of frustration when at times we're rearresting the same person, you know, twice in the same day. And they're not, there's no resources there to help.
So Marissa Magnus, so where are there places that are doing a good job doing what Chris and Chief Hamill were describing?
Yeah,
right?
And
so,
actually,
I mean, who can we look to get ideas on how to make that happen?
Well, there's great stuff happening here. Project Kinship, I spoke with yesterday. Stephen Kim couldn't be here today, but he went through his work with Santa Ana PD, the formerly incarcerated individuals that they have on stipend that work at Project Kinship. They have a monthly clinic every month dealing with Prop 47 felony reduction and with other needs that individuals might have. I spoke with the Orange County Reentry Partnership. So there's already, as you both pointed out, robust partnerships here in this county. And I'll make two quick plugs. Will, if you raise your hand, Will, back here, we have a brief that we issued earlier this year, How to Address Low-Level Crime, that has examples from across the state. One of the examples, you mentioned drug courts earlier. You're right, drug court participation declined after Prop 47. Part of that was the criteria of drug courts. They were for felony offenses. And so it took a while for courts to say, well, we need to allow misdemeanants in, and we can we need to collaborate with the mental health court and see, see how we can work together. So Santa Barbara, I spoke with their chief probation officer. Santa Barbara has adjusted the criteria on their drug court and their mental health court. Law enforcement assisted diversion is coming out. We'll have that brief, and we're publishing our two-year Prop 47 report at the end of this year that goes through gaps that have been identified by various agencies, emerging promising practices that should be taken to scale, that we've, there are actual examples in there, and then a list of recommendations. So that'll be on our website by the end of this year with just that conversation.
Magnus, any ideas?
Well, no, I think in general, I mean, there are clearly promising strategies that are out there, and there's some success. I think what we need is to take a close look and do a thorough evaluation of the various promising programs and really then see what works, who does it work for, where can it be replicated, to get a sense of how many individuals can really be part of this, and we can get success that way. So it's evaluation of these various programs is really needed.
Well, I think, I mean, the thing I hear as someone that is nowhere near, has the expertise of any of you, is the value of collaboration, right? And so that there's all these different factors that are interrelated. And in Sacramento, anyway, they're now investing more, and there's a name for it, but sort of to address homelessness by putting people somewhere into housing and then having this whole network of services like you're describing that, you know, this sort of different way of doing intake, Chris, that you were describing, to sort of, you know, rather than thou shalt not, but to sort of get at what the core issues are. It makes a lot of sense. Questions from you all? Sir? Well, or somebody can bring you a mic, maybe. It's nice to see you, Bob. Okay, so there isn't a lot of time for questions, so if we don't do yours, it's not me, you know, just picking on you. Some excellent penmanship here. Well, let's start with, I'm sorry, I'm going to make a little noise here because with the microphone. California property crime has increased about 7%. This is from what, from 2014 or just year to year, year over year?
Yeah. Okay. 2014 to 2015, yeah.
Irvine property crime has risen about 25%. How much of the property crime is focused on the Asian American community? And if that's not known, is it more, less, or insignificant? Because there's a belief in that community that they're targets.
Sure. The interesting thing about Irvine is changing a bit now, but historically, Irvine is very integrated. So unlike other regions, other densely populated areas, you don't have, say, one section of Irvine that is, say, Chinese American, another section that is Hispanic, Caucasian, et cetera. So when we see crime, and if you look at, say, a pin map of crime in Irvine, property crime in Irvine, again, Irvine is different from other cities. You don't tend to see these clusters of crime in different regions. It's almost like it looks like a shotgun blast on a map. To a degree, anecdotally, we have some information about if certain populations are being victimized more than others, and we're not seeing that in Irvine. We're not seeing that our Asian American population is being victimized at a higher rate than any other population.
Anyone else on that one? I had another question. This was sort of, I like this one. If a small group of repeat offenders, like the ones mentioned by Chief Hamill, are responsible for a large percentage of property crimes, does it make sense to address them separately? And if that does make sense, my addition would be, okay, then how do you do that? Or can you, go for it,
Jeff. Yeah. Well, I would agree with that. We do see that oftentimes there are a small group of offenders that are responsible for a larger percentage of crime. Those numbers can fluctuate, I think. But I mean, I would say that we do, that when we become aware of a repeat offender, that we try our very best to all resources at our disposal as far as enforcement, as far as trying to get the person into programs, working with other agencies, whether it be probation, or other task forces to deal with these issues and address them head on. But through different kinds of crime analysis software, through just the knowledge of individual beat officers that are assigned to a given area for a specified period of time, we do become aware of repeat offenders rather quickly, and then we can use our best resources to address those issues.
Greg, can I add?
Yes, you can. And then I've got a question for you when you're done.
Okay. That is what many jurisdictions are doing in the Valley. I work with Chief Green. We meet about once a month in a big coalition. And in the Valley, there was a big uptick of shoplifting. It started in liquor stores and then moved on to other kind of 7-Eleven type stores. And so what was really interesting there is law enforcement worked with the retailers and with the community organization to develop a focused deterrent sort of response to those individuals that were committing theft, specifically in liquor stores. Sometimes they were underage, and it started out with cutouts of officers sort of that laying out when that offense could be a felony, and everyone sort of laughed at it, and the officer who posed for it. But then they added training to the retailers on how to do things differently in the store to help prevent theft, and they had little cards to the retailers, and then it worked. The data showed afterwards, we have to see if there was a trend, but that's one way. In High Point, North Carolina, the police department addressed chronic shoplifting with the targeted deterrent model. Trying to identify what those drivers are and then making that a response, giving a response to what those drivers might be. So I'm familiar just with LAPD, what's going on in South Bureau. The beat officers were like, I keep arresting the same guy. I know he needs treatment. Where can I send him? So we go in, connect them with CBOs, even if there's not a formal partnership. Deputy Chief Scott would say, a provider might be around the corner and we don't even know. What can we do to get this guy some help and get him off the street? And importantly, so my officer can concentrate on more serious crime.
I've got one here, and I have an idea of where it came from, but can you comment on the recent report from the Center on Juvenile and Criminal Justice, September of 2016, which found that there was no correlation between county crime rate increases in the year after Prop 47 and Prop 47-related prison releases or jail population decreases?
There was, I think it was September, CJCJ issued a report. It's early, still in the data, but they're trying to look at what is causing these upticks. Importantly, was it the prison releases? There were about, at this point now, I think it's nearly 5,000 individuals released from state prison. So they were looking at counties that released a lot more individuals. Did they see an increase in crime rates versus counties that maybe didn't have that many people that were released? And what they saw was that the outcomes were all over the place. Counties that saw big releases saw either decreases in crime or not as big an increase as the counties that had smaller releases. So they didn't find a causal connection to Prop 47. In LA, in Los Angeles, City Attorney Mike Feuer was asking the same question. What's up with the uptick in crime? Commissioned a study with DOJ, same thing. They were looking for a connection. They didn't find a causal connection with most crime in Los Angeles. And Magnus, I think, is going to be working on maybe such a report soon.
Yeah, no, we are in the process of trying to answer this question if there is a relationship between Prop 47 and crime rates. And I think that it's more complex than simply looking at the correlation between some changes in the jail incarceration and the prison incarceration and the crime rates from a particular point in time and then another one. So it's more complex. Those are not the only factors. We talked about everything that Prop 47 did here, and you're just looking at two important changes that it brought about. So I'm not trying to say that they might not be a link that one should look at. They certainly are, but I think it requires a little bit more. They're very county-specific changes as well, that other changes that could be related to what you see in these particular measures. I think, to credibly and reliably answer that question, you have to take a broader perspective, come in from when do the changes start? I mean, we've talked about year-over-year changes here. Did these changes in the crime rates, did they start before November of 2014? Let's take a look at when they started to change. Let's look at what the counties that experienced this, these increases the most. What are the characteristics of them? Are there changes in incarceration there? What about changes in arrests and particular types of arrests? Are the links there? How do we compare California to other states? We've done this successfully in terms of analysis for answering the question of whether realignment had an impact on crime. Let's do a similar kind of analysis for Prop 47. And once we have all these various strategies, you know, methods to try to answer that same question, see where it lands and what it tells us about the impact of Prop 47 and crime. Then we'll talk
and
a little more.
This issue that Magnus just noted, there's 58 counties in California, some so different geographically, rural, some have a public defender, some don't. So there's 58 mini jurisdictions where statewide reform is being implemented. And how it's being implemented is also a factor. How does that county spend its community corrections partnership funds? Is it focusing on the same practices as before, or is it going into services and programs? What other demographic shifts might be happening in that county? So there's this look at 58 counties. There's also one other element we haven't mentioned yet, and I feel really terrible because we are always talking about the second chances narrative. All of the people who had an old felony conviction for simple drug possession or petty theft, they, if they're eligible, they are able to change their records. And as we say, change your record, change your life. These are also individuals who are now able to access employment opportunities that they were before shut out of, housing opportunities, education. That affects their, you know, how, what direction their life might go. There are 4,800 restrictions placed on you if you have a felony in California. There are occupational restrictions, occupational licensing restrictions. 73%, 58% are employment related, 58% of those restrictions, 73% of them are lifetime bans. So if you can change your felony to a misdemeanor, think of the opportunities you now have access to, primarily employment.
Thank you. Chief Hamill, you get the last word because we're out of time.
Sure. Marissa just mentioned the fact that many of the people were able to petition to have their felony changed to misdemeanor. So that also applied to people that were actually incarcerated when Prop 47 took effect. And so you saw nearly an immediate release of thousands of people that were previously incarcerated back in the communities. And then the question was also asked, when did we start seeing these increases in crime? It was right after Prop 47 when many prisoners who were previously incarcerated were released back in the community. Also, I just wanted to reference the report that was mentioned from Juvenile Justice. And while it's true that the report found no causal connection between the passage of Prop 47 increase in crime, the report also didn't say that Prop 47 wasn't responsible. In fact, it said that it's too early to conclusively measure the effects of Prop 47 on crime rates just 1 year into the passage. So again, I do agree that much more research is needed. But again, I just wanted to share that.
Okay, so say thanks to this panel for the wonderful job they did. I'm gonna just take a brief, can we do that? Take like just a minute or two? What?
What do we do?
2 minutes? 5 minutes? 2 minutes. Okay, we'll take a quick break.
Thank you, it's good to see you.
Good to see you.
Having a good panel like this.
Thanks, my pleasure. Good to be here.
This is my old stomping ground.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Donna would want me to say hi.
No. I will.
It's cool. If I was him, I wouldn't be here either.
Is that my outside voice?
Thank you.
If everyone could start finding their way to their seats, we're going to get the second panel started here in a minute. Thank you.
Okay, let's take your seats and we'll start. Now for something completely different.
No.
We could do that. Okay, well, so we've got a second panel here that's going to focus on Prop 57, and I'm taking to heart this mild criticism of the moderator, which says, hey, can you please define and explain the language of Prop 47 and Prop 57 before we begin our discussion? So, yes, we will do that. I would probably trust members of the panel to do a better job of it than I. But before we begin, let me introduce who's up here now. Next to me is Senator Bob Hertzberg, who I didn't know this, is the first former Assembly Speaker in 86 years to be elected to the California State Senate. He represents the San Fernando Valley. We've known each other for a long time. You know, aside from being super cool, one of the things that Bob focuses on in his legislation is trying to find ways to make government operate better, save taxpayer money, and be more responsive to 21st century needs. And there's certainly plenty of ways that government could do that. Next to him is Orange County's Undersheriff Don Barnes, who's been with the Orange County Sheriff's Department for 27 years, is that? Okay.
Yes.
And as undersheriff, he's the organization's chief operating officer, overseeing the daily operations of the department's 3,800 employees. Next to him is Professor Carol Sarin, who works in the Department of Criminology, Law and Society, right here at the University of California, Irvine, and has an appointment also holds an appointment to the Department of Sociology and the School of Law. And some of her research, recent research, touches on the very things we're talking about today, which, shockingly enough, is probably why she's here on the panel.
Shocking.
Go figure. And finally, but not least, is Drew Soderborg of the Legislative Analyst's Office did you come down from Sacramento, right?
Okay. That's correct,
Did you come down this morning?
I did.
Oh, brutal.
So,
okay. All right.
Yeah, so if I stop making sense, it's all exhaustion on my part.
Well, that happens to me all the time, regardless of when I fly. But Drew is the managing principal analyst with the California Legislative Analyst's Office, focusing on criminal justice and juvenile justice issues.
Is that Mike Cohen's old job?
So So just to briefly do the greatest hits, and whoever wants to do it, or we can do it in conjunction. What is Proposition 57? Just passed, so it's not like Prop 47 where, you know, we can really make a lot of...
Sure.
There's a lot to look at as to what its impact might be.
Yeah, I'd be happy to tackle that one. So our office is responsible for writing the voter guide that was mailed out to all registered voters. So that's kind of what brings me here. Prop 57 can really be thought of in three distinct pieces. First, it would allow nonviolent offenders to be considered for release before they have served time for any other minor crimes that they've been convicted of at the same time they were convicted of for their primary crime, as well as any time that they'd otherwise have to serve for sentencing enhancements. Also, it allows the state prison system to award credits to inmates beyond the limits that are currently set in statute if inmates participate in rehabilitation programs or exhibit good behavior. And then those first two are really focused on the adult portions of the system. The last portion is focused on the juvenile portion of the system. So under current law, some youth are tried in adult court either automatically or at the discretion of a prosecutor due to the crime they are accused of and or their criminal history. Under Proposition 57, before a youth can be tried in adult court, they'd have to first appear in front of a juvenile court judge who would decide whether or not they're appropriate for adult court. So those are the three pieces.
Now, so when Governor Brown would pitch people to vote for it, he would describe it as we're returning from determinate sentencing to indeterminate sentencing. And the ballot, you know, the summary you're just describing doesn't talk about that. Can you talk about determinate versus indeterminate sentencing?
I mean, basically it's one that gives you specific numbers of years as determinate versus indeterminate. It's a range of time at which you're allowed to have a hearing by the parole board at the beginning of that. If it's 25 to life, you're allowed to have a hearing to determine whether or not you're eligible for release at the beginning versus a determinate sentence that says you're getting so many years and you can't have a look at that. And really what it is, I think, if I could just take a moment.
Knock yourself out.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at, you know, I was 20 years ago, I was the chairman of the Public Safety Committee in the legislature. And it was, you know, when Jerry Brown was governor, the first Jerry Brown, he's the one who dealt with this whole issue of determinate versus indeterminate. And what's abundantly clear is that although it doesn't say the proposition, the language, the way it's written, and we just talked about briefly, it really is Jerry Brown coming back and saying, wait a second, there's 440 enhancements that occurred, many of which, quite frankly, and I made mistakes, happened under my watch as chairman of the Public Safety Committee, because what happened, if you look at the big picture of the last, say, 30 or 40 years in the area of public safety, we came along with the three strikes and with all these kinds of tough guy stuff that happened. We have a population of prison capacity of 82,000. It went up in 2006 to 136,000. And so the notion was, we were just locking up everybody, the largest prison population across the planet, I think, if I remember right, on a per capita basis. Yep. Just extraordinary. Under Wilson, we built a lot of prisons. I think there's 33 or 34 prisons now. I visited almost all of them when I was in either as a lawyer, representing wrongly accused people, or...
That's implicit, Bob.
Of course. Yeah, right. I've never practiced criminal law. That means you lost your case. But there's this extraordinary growth of the prison guards as a population. One of my first bills on the floor of the legislature that I lost to Republicans was trying to take women out of a prison that was one of these block prisons and use that for men who would, you know, were typical crimes and put them in the community where they weren't as challenging. And it was the Republicans, quite frankly, I'm a Democrat, who were pushing like crazy to keep the prisons as opposed to reducing costs and bringing women who were less violent offenders and the like closer to their families. So what's happened has been, and actually when I was chairman of the Public Safety Committee, we had 705 bills in 1 year. It was just a staggering number because everybody at those times, crime was up, they wanted to be tough on crime and more enhancements. You know, you looked the wrong way, you did anything wrong, it was enhance, enhance, enhance. And you saw crime rates drop dramatically over the last number of years, the reasons of which, other people can answer, but they And so now what you've seen in the legislature is not as much focus. You've seen Prop 47, the governor comes back with 57, this whole kind of shift away from prisons for prisons. You got the 2011 decision by Justice Kennedy that says that, you know, the California courts are unconstitutional, I mean, prisons are unconstitutional. And the last element is you got $8 billion being spent on health care through a federal trustee in the prisons. So you've got this unbelievable cluster of spending of money, crime's down, interest is down. Governor comes back with AB 109, Prop 47, Prop 57, changing the game. And so we're really in kind of the, as the pendulum swings in this kind of larger context of how public policy works, of what the next chapter is, if you will.
Yeah, I was going to ask you under Sheriff Barnes, so how do you visualize Prop 57 affecting Orange County?
Well, I think we can see that it's probably going to be Prop 47 sequel. First thing, I think the interest is not down. I think that to make the proposal that interest is down in crime is dependent on whether you're a victim of crime. So to say that crime is down, and we don't know why, crime is down because we incarcerated the worst criminals and put them in the state prison system. And if we have a decriminalization effort, which Prop 47 was, and move that into Prop 57, crime will cycle back up. You can't decriminalize criminal behavior and expect crime to stay low. The things about Prop 57 that bother me is it was being presented by the governor as further reductions in the state prison population, based on this 137% cap. Well, when this was being legislated, brought forward, the state was already below that 137.5% cap. They were about 135%. So the whole premise of Prop 57 was already not necessary. They're already below that cap and probably cycled to still reduce with AB 109, the shifting of state prisoners onto local facilities. Those numbers will arguably stay low because the population returning to state prison is simply not there. The other issue that's troubling, I think, for many people.
I'm sorry, it exacerbates the conditions created by AB 109?
No, AB 109 is a shifting of
right.
into the local. So the population that prior that would have returned to state prison is lower than it would have been before.
Sorry.
So that cap, exceeding that cap, probably is not likely to occur. Right. The other thing I think that bothers me is how it's billed, the legislation. Some of those enhancements are necessary. Gang members who possess a gun while committing a crime is, I think, a very significant enhancement, especially if you live and you're victimized in those neighborhoods where those crimes occur. So I don't think that those neighbors are really complaining that gang members aren't getting the enhancements they need because you're, once again, encouraging the behavior to continue if you don't hold them accountable for the crimes that they occur, which I think is problematic. But those nonviolent offenses that are being referred to, that's only for the carrying crime that they are convicted of. It doesn't take into criminal past, doesn't take into prior convictions for crime, and that's tied to the legislative definition of violent, which doesn't include a lot of what I think the public would assume would be violent crimes. Rape of an unconscious person is not listed as a violent crime in the penal code. Assault and battery is not a violent crime. Assault, corporal injury to a child is not considered a violent crime. So all these crimes that are by definition not violent, I think is kind of set it up to be unnecessary.
Professor?
I just want to make two points. One is Prop 57 was passed not less than a month ago, and it's really, really premature to make any projections about its impact on crime or not. Certainly Magnus discussed that at length with regard to Prop 47. So it's really important to not conflate anecdotal evidence or assumptions from a more rigorous analysis of an impact or an intervention of one way, of one type or another. And I'd like to make another point that was kind of alluded to a few minutes ago. Chris Bieber went back to AB 109, and I think it's also important to put on the table how we got to AB 109. The work that I did really, which I think is what got me on this panel, was around the impact of AB 109 and what led up to it, a project I did with my colleague Charis Kubrin. And one of the things that's important to know about that is that the litigation that was alluded to a minute ago went on for 20 years until it finally got to the Supreme Court. It went back and forth between the district court in the Northern District of California, the Middle District of California, in Coleman and Plata, and up to the Ninth Circuit with a three-judge panel, back down to the district court until it finally got to the Supreme Court of the United States in 2011 when the two cases were joined and the Supreme Court ruled, Justice Kennedy writing the opinion, that California's prisons were in violation of the Eighth Amendment of the Constitution and constituted cruel and unusual punishment. This is not a radical left court. This is a pretty conservative court to reach that conclusion. If you haven't read the decision, I really invite you to look at it. It's a pretty graphic description of the way California's prisons looked at the time. And it was on the heels of that that Plata was passed, and that, I mean, excuse me, that AB 109 was passed, and money was allocated down to each of the 58 counties to develop experiments, or strategies that worked at the local level. The kind of the rationale of AB 109 was that communities could deal more effectively with non-sexual, non-violent, non-serious individuals. So these were kind of low-hanging fruit with AB 109. Now, one of the concerns is that with, you know, sort of the litigators, prisons rights advocates, is that will just result in 58 Platas. That is that we'll just return the problem to the county level. And I'll make one last point. We can come back and talk about other implications of AB 109 and so forth. But I want to make one last point with regard to the Supreme Court decision and why I think it's important to put that on the table. California, for good or ill, has one of the most sophisticated prison rights bars in the United States. And if you're interested in knowing why that's the case, I can point you to an article that appeared in, I didn't write it, this great article, so I can say that. So there is a prison rights advocacy community in the state of California that is extremely expert in this particular area, and I think is kind of watching this very closely, that the expectation is that we, as was suggested a few minutes ago, that we're really at a point where we need to turn the corner and not incarcerate everyone either at the state level or at the county level. So I'll just leave it at that.
Okay, I was going to ask Drew a question, but yeah.
Go ahead, please.
You know, well, I was just going to ask, so I read it last night and I've forgotten. Are there projected cost savings from Proposition 57?
Yeah, so we do project cost savings for the state from Proposition 57. It depends heavily on how the measure is implemented. So the parole consideration provisions of the measure, essentially what the measure does is give CDCR the ability to adopt regulations on how they're going to carry out this parole consideration for nonviolent offenders, which could really affect how significant that portion is. So right now there are about 16,000 inmates who are in state prison who are immediately eligible for parole consideration once the regulations are complete. Depending on how many of those get out, you could see the prison population be reduced by a few thousand inmates, which could create tens of millions of dollars of savings. Now, the effect
there's
on
no pass-through thing like in 47,
correct.
Right? Yeah, okay.
Correct. And then there's also an effect on the counties. It has less to do with the adult portions. There's not sort of a direct effect on the counties from the adult portions, unless, of course, the individuals who are released go on to commit new crimes and become a county responsibility. But the juvenile portion does affect counties because by keeping people in the juvenile court system, the county share of costs for those youth is higher. And so we estimate that counties will be probably experiencing a few million dollars in increased cost annually as a result of that.
Don, you wanted to say something.
Yeah, I was going to mention that when we talk about the mention of cost savings, is at the state level. There are costs that are transferred on to the real cost, tangible cost, as mentioned. We're starting off our fiscal year in the Sheriff's Department $16 million short. So $2 million of shortage or additional costs onto my budget is not chump change. That's significant. You have to then decide what we're not going to do at the expense of doing something else. It also doesn't take into impact, and nobody's calculated the social costs. They were alluded to several times, but when crime goes up and somebody is now the victim of crime, there are social costs that can be imposed upon society. Each theft has a social cost per the RAND Corporation, about $2,000 of social cost. Mm-hmm. Burglaries are about $13,000 in social costs. These are Prop 47 related crimes that have real costs that are placed upon victims, families, communities, in lost revenue, lost productivity, fear of crime, intangibles that go with these associated crimes. So to say that there are savings, the savings never manifest. The savings never manifested in Prop 47. They won't manifest in Prop 57. Prop 64 with medical marijuana, now recreational marijuana, says all these revenues will come in. Look to Colorado. They never happen. The costs are significantly higher than the savings or the revenue generations. That's passed on to us. We bear those costs. There's no savings. It's going to be more outlay. And it's competing interest resources. We have to deal with all these other things now that are introduced back into society. As Chief Hamill and Chief Bieber have referred to, it's never been the intent of law enforcement to be the first resource for mental illness. 25% of the 6,000 inmates in Orange County Jail have significant mental ill problems. It's the largest mental health hospital in the county, and we deal with that. We've never been intended to be the primary intervention strategy for homelessness. The gap between the issues and those who are trying to solve the problems is non-existent. The social services aren't there. Prop 47 is the same thing. These programs, and I will agree, I'm in the business of putting myself out of business. We are in the business of reducing crime down to zero. But those gaps don't exist. Programmatically, they don't exist. We have for many years had a highlight national program called juvenile intervention. The PRIDE program in the Sheriff's Department. Yeah. Post Prop 47, with the decriminalization of violations, the interest in that program has diminished. Drug courts went down in some counties 50% because there's no carrot to dangle anymore. And when they went down too low, they started including other crimes to keep the numbers up, to inflate the numbers. So the analysis, I will agree, is problematic. But here's the problem with the analysis. It's based on uniform crime reporting by the FBI, which is a hierarchical categorization of crime. Most Prop 47 crimes don't get counted because it's the most significant crime, and they're the ones fall off the map. So it's not that something didn't happen. I can tell you with all certainty, on November 6, 2014, something happened that shifted crime to start going the other direction, Prop 47. Anecdotally, they'll say that because you can't data mine out the statistics, because data mining it is too problematic to try to get the numbers to justify one way or the other. So I can tell you that it's changed.
Bob?
Thank you. I agree with you on the analysis with respect to savings, which I want to address in a moment. But the thing that's important to know with respect to Prop 57, of course, as you correctly note, we have no information because it just was passed. It does not release one person. It doesn't do anything except give them a hearing at which professionals will make a determination. That's it. So in other words, instead of having a system of justice that treats people like a number, it looks at data on each individual human being with professionals at the parole board who make those determinations. That is what it does. So there's no release of a single anybody unless there's a professional. So it takes away the automatic and puts in the human. That's what's important in that determination of Prop 57. We'll see what it looks like. Second.
It offers a higher level of flexibility, right?
A level of flexibility. There was no flexibility based upon judgment.
Sorry.
Second issue is bail. I was going to do this last year, but Governor Brown has this Prop 57 that sucked the oxygen out of the room, and so I'm doing it this year. It's bail reform. 63% of people in your county jails across the state are pretrial detainees. Pre-trial detainees. That means nobody's made a determination, and so many of those people can't afford to get out of jail because they don't got the few hundred bucks to get out of jail. There was a Federal Reserve study done last year. 47% of people in America don't have the 400 bucks
couldn't come up with $400 unless they borrowed it from somebody else or sold something. So you get arrested and you get put in jail, and the guy next to you has the $5,000 or $3,000 or $1,500 bucks to get out, and you don't. And you know what happens? You sit there, and you sit there, and you sit there, and you cop to a plea after sitting there for 40 days for credit, for time served, for a crime you'd never been convicted of, and your jails are full of 63%. I don't know what your population is in Orange County, but across the state it's 63%. The burden, when you add that to Prop 47, is nothing less than extraordinary. The question is, as it's done in Kentucky, as done in Washington, D.C., as done in the federal government, there should be a judicial determination, again, a set of educated eyes that ask the two questions. One, are you a threat to society and should you remain in jail? Two, are you a flight risk? Are you going to show up? There's a whole host of very successful processes of reminding people, all kinds of stuff that have been unbelievably successful in making sure people show up. So that could dramatically reduce the impact of what's talking about. Second, the last thing I want to address, the point you raised about cost savings, because the great and incredible Senator Moorlach, who I serve with on the, I'm chairman of the Governance and Finance Committee that oversees all the local government stuff, basically the whole fight between the state and the federal government all the time is about money since 1978. Everybody's fighting over dough. You know, savings, you're right. Everybody's begging the state for money, the state's begging the federal government for money, and the taxpayers pay the dough. Bottom line is, you're right, I don't think there'll be any savings. The numbers that you guys gave and the estimates that I saw, the LAO report, was a $571 million increase to $12.6 billion in the corrections budget for between 15, 16, 17. So it's going up. I don't think there will be any savings. And if there is savings, you're exactly right. Everybody's going to grab it for their own purposes and find out a reason why they need the dough more than you need the dough. And there's always that tension that exists. So I don't think you're going to see real savings in a lot of this stuff. And you're going to continue to see the kind of fight that we see all the time in our committee over local government saying, you state are stealing our money, or we are given mandates, or all the other kinds of things, which the beat will go on.
Wow, you're such a buzzkill. I'm going to go to Carol.
I want to go back to something that Sheriff Barnes said, and I guess I'm sort of like the providing the perspective on this panel as the academic here, but sociologists and criminologists have been studying policing for generations, and one of the things that one recurring pattern that we see in these studies is that police officers are on the front line, and they do often play both a role of social control and social work, a suggestion that was made earlier. But I want to pick up on the point that Sheriff Barnes made, because we are, as he pointed out, putting all of the burden on policing at this point. When he describes the kinds of roles and what they see, and the people that are in jails and prisons when they should be in mental health institutions, that is exactly what the case is. And if we, I mean, that's a collateral problem related to this, but we're not going to get a police force that is going to be willing to collaborate when they constantly feel that they have their finger in the dike. So, you know, I think that the point that he's raising and the perspective that he's offering is one that is really corroborated by research, and in order for police to collaborate with probation and the other sectors of the criminal justice system, which is what all these initiatives are pushing, we have to recognize the enormous burden that we're putting on police officers that is really historically different. So I'll just leave it at that. But.
It's true.
Drew? I just wanted to talk a little bit about savings and the way our office goes about estimating savings. So really, when we look at the impact of a measure, what we're trying to do is figure out how much would the state spend if the measure hadn't passed. In the case of Prop 47, the state prison population would have been about 5,000 inmates higher, which, because of the overcrowding limit put on by the federal courts, the state would have had to buy 5,000 additional contract beds. And that actually is consistent with what we estimated in the voter guide of about between $100 and $200 million in extra costs, a little closer to $100 million in extra costs for the state a year. So those costs were avoided. Part of the reason the savings estimate has come in lower is because of a difference in methodology used by the Department of Finance in estimating the savings. So when an inmate comes into the state prison, they can either be put in contract beds or be housed in one of the 34 state prisons. A contract bed is about $29,000 per year, whereas one of the 34 state prisons is closer to about $12,000 a year. So when we looked at Prop 47, we assumed that had it not passed, all 5,000 of those inmates would have been in contract beds, because if that weren't the case, the state would have violated the limit and had to release some of them. Whereas the Department of Finance assumed that some of those would have been in the state's 34 prisons, even though that would have triggered a release, which doesn't make sense from our perspective. So I think that's important to keep in mind, that even though you see the corrections budget increasing year over year, some of these propositions are still resulting in cost savings because it would have increased even more had they not been implemented.
Got it. Sheriff Barnes, you were going to say something earlier.
Yeah, I was just going to comment on AB19 a little further, because we talk about the lack of impacts to the community, and there are significant impacts to the Orange County Jail. The shift of those prisoners into the Orange County Jail system, we have now 35 state prison inmates housed in Orange County serving sentences of 5 years or more, one of them 16 to 18 years, in a facility not designed for long-term incarceration. And those will continue to shift onto the burden of the Sheriff's Department. They cause problems. Drug trafficking in the Orange County jail system increased 300% since AB 109. That's a significant number. That population is only about 12%. They're responsible for 25% of the problems, the assaults, the discipline issues within the Orange County jail system. So this is shifting. And what makes it more difficult about Prop 57, if somebody is released, and there will be people released under Prop 57, and they violate the terms of their release, they come back to the county jail. They don't go back to state prison. We get them as a parole violator, not the state prison. So it's a continued shift onto the county to carry the burden of the criminal element as they violate and come into the jail system. Prop 47 passed about 59%. I think the problem, and if you ask, and we had many people ask us afterwards, when you are the victim of a crime and you think we caught them, good for us, and then you issue them a ticket and let them walk to the curb, that's hard for the public to reconcile how you were victimized and now you're being re-victimized by a criminal justice process that does not hold criminals accountable for their behavior. So these that keep on happening, it's very, very difficult, I think, to quantify to the public why criminals aren't being taken off the street. The issue that was brought up on the previous panel about some of the successes, you only have to look about 100 years ago to the Hawthorne study that says when you pay attention to something and saturate resources on something, you're going to have a positive impact. So these direct patrol allocation and saturation models where you go in and attack a problem is always going to have the impact in the, that was referred to in the previous panel. But they come at cost. There's additional cost burdens placed on enforcement, overtime, other aspects, or it's being done at the expense of not doing something else. Something else isn't getting done to do these types of saturation and directed enforcement opportunities. And there's a place for that. It just can't be the sole solution in how to deal with those criminal spikes.
Carol?
So I want to make 2 points. One is with regard to AB 109. When that legislation was passed, counties were mandated to work across the criminal justice system. We sort of heard that in the prior panel. To come up with a plan for the way in which that county was going to handle those, not what they're called the non-non-nons, that were returned to the county for supervision. Some counties, and this was work that was done at PIC by Reichen Grutte and Mia Bird, some counties opted to build more beds, what we might think of as enforcement counties, including Orange County, I should add. And some counties opted for what we might think of as more rehabilitative approaches that developed work-based programs, drug intervention programs to ease the person back into the community. And what's interesting about this particular finding is that the counties that went the rehabilitative route had significantly lower recidivism rates. It's another issue we haven't raised. We can talk about crime. We can also talk about recidivism, which is extremely hard to measure, because how long of a time do you have to be on the street and not have been arrested for a crime from your prior incidents? The length of time, figuring out what constitutes a recidivism rate is not an easy thing. It's kind of like figuring out the causes of crime. But in any case, the counties that, from what we saw post-109, that took a more rehabilitative route had significant reductions in recidivism compared to the counties that took a more enforcement route. And that's, and when you think about it, you know, it's not that surprising. I mean, if you kind of equip people to reenter the community rather than just drop them in the community, you're going to probably have some improvements. And I just want to make one comment about the Hawthorne effect. Sheriff Barnes suggested.
I've been promoted twice while I've been up here.
What is the Hawthorne effect?
So the Hawthorne effect is that when you study a group of people, this was done in a factory, Westinghouse factory, at the beginning of the 20th century, and you focus a lot of attention on them, they're going to perform better. So it's the phenomenon of being studied that improves the outcome.
Heisenberg uncertainty principle.
Okay. So, but fortunately, social scientists do learn from their mistakes, and we have improved methods of evaluation, ways that we do blind and double-blind tests to determine whether to sort out whether or not whether or not an intervention has a positive or negative effect. So it's true that there is this Hawthorne phenomenon, but we do have more sophisticated ways of evaluating the impact of an intervention than was the case at the beginning of the 20th century.
I just want to make a comment because this is important. We are adding jail beds. We have a jail expansion project that's been going on since 1994. And in response to the changes in our population, rather than being an incarceration-based bed, the 850 beds we're adding are reentry, programmatically designed for those to reenter inmates into society for success. They're not just punitive. About recidivism, this is going to be the tricky part when we start measuring recidivism, because it is challenging. But we know from the past, before AB 109, that the most likely period when somebody is going to re-violate, re-offend, would be in the 12 months prior release. So AB 109, what it also did was reduce the number of people being watched. It reduced that number from 115,000 to 46,000. So we have a lot more people being watched and studied. The population's reduced. And if you look at recidivism, because the number's lower, the recidivists are likely to be lower, and I will predict it'll probably be claimed as a victory. AB 109 will say recidivism's down, this is a success. They just reduced the population significantly to make the numbers lower than they would have been prior to that. Also, there's a change in the definition of recidivism. Those returned to state prison. These people aren't going back to state prison. So that definition changed as well. It's all kind of being built towards success. If you look at, and what I've had people ask me about Prop 47, that 59% passage rate would have never happened if it wasn't billed as the Safe Schools and Communities Act. Yes. It was a tagline that people thought will make this community safer. Prop 47, reentering people, or whether they're minor violators or not, has done nothing to make the community or school safer by putting people back on the street. So legislation is going to come up in a little bit about future legislation. I'd like to see one of the senators here today care legislation called the Safe Truth in Advertising Act for how these things are being billed and put on the ballot. Call it what it is.
Ain't that the truth?
You know, you were going to say, Bob.
I was. Let me tell you, that's the truth. I've seen it all over the place. I did a crime lab act, and I mislabeled it, and it didn't pass back whenever that was, and I had to build the crime lab at Cal State LA. We gave you a bunch of money when I was there, too. But what I wanted to say was,
I guarantee you Orange County would not have gotten any of that money.
I promise you. Scotty Bach called me and said, I got only Republicans. I can't get this done. Will you do me a favor? I got the sheriff who needs $10 million. Boom, I put it in. Next case. Because we're a bipartisan guy. We took care of you. And all those beds you're talking about, we gave you the money way back when. But I want to share a context here, because this is important. And you've got the former Republican leader here from the Senate, Bob Huff. And he knows this. You know, we sit here and we talk about this level of detail.
As was mentioned, I used to be the Speaker of the House, and you know what happens in these jobs and what happens in California is everybody comes to you and says the rotation of the earth's going to stop unless you give me money for developmentally disabled, or money to fill potholes, or money to pay for glasses for kids in school, or hungry kids coming to school, or you know, you just got a PPIC just got a report coming out on higher eds and like what's the cost of schools and the debt for the kids here at UC and all of those issues. And what happens is our job at the appropriate constitutional level is to govern for the common good, is to govern for the republic. But what happens is here we talk, one of the great challenges that we face, you know, public safety is the most important aspect of government, in my judgment, and I certainly wouldn't want to be a police officer today. The story earlier about having releasing the same people over and over again, you know, I'd be an officer, what do you do? It's just, you gotta be going nuts. Personally, it's got to be just horribly difficult, plus also the social impacts of mental health and drug dual diagnosis and all those other issues. But all I want to do is to share contextually, we have a conference here that Senator Moorlach and others put together dealing with this one issue. I just want to share that there's so many other pieces and components. When you look at the study of the impact, social impact on crime, well, there's also a zillion other social impacts, and how do you weigh all those? I'm not providing an answer. I'm just trying to give you some context of how challenging it is, as Mr. Huff knows, because he had to live through it, when you're dealing with these unbelievable array of issues and a limited resource of people and nobody wanting to pay for it.
Right, so just to the panel as a whole, I mean, this came up in the previous panel, right? So the question of there's responsibilities placed on your agency, right, that are more rightfully belong in another agency. How do you, and your budget is short, how do you foster the kind of cooperation Bob's talking about? Because it is, there's so many different factors that
we got to make sure that the state library has plenty of money, too.
I had the good manners not to bring it up.
No worry.
But thank you.
I love the library.
Yeah.
Well, first, I want to qualify a comment that was made about the number of the reductions in law enforcement. And because of that, it does make us more efficient and more effective what we do. But that doesn't mean that we're not doing the job. And we have vacancies we're carrying. We gap that with overtime. I'm very proud of our young law enforcement officers who do the job today. They're still showing up. Our academies are still full. We're running 8 academies a year, the most we've ever done. We have 80 new cops per class. So it's not that there's not an interest in people getting into this profession. They're great individuals who are getting in and show up every day and do the job. And they deserve our respect in doing that. Recent study came out a couple weeks ago that the confidence in law enforcement is at a 20-year high. This is on the backs of 2015, where people couldn't kick us in the shins enough over the job that we were doing. So we've got great people doing the job. It is about resources and different things. We just started several new programs in the Sheriff's Department because we realize there's gaps. One of them was a naloxone program where we look at drug trends. Fentanyl is a drug trend made it out to the California coast. It's 50 times more potent than heroin. Carfentanil is 100 times more potent than fentanyl. So contact will flatline you. We now have the ability to save lives on the street. We're taking our responsibilities very seriously. We have a cyber crimes unit we just started up because crime is changing. You don't rob somebody in an ATM anymore. You can do it from the other side of the earth and commit a robbery. So all these things are huge, and we have to morph and change, but we need the support. These are very costly measures. We do a lot more with a lot less, but we can't do everything with nothing. We have to have the resources to do the job that's necessary for us to do.
So on the mental health issues that you mentioned in the inmates, does the Orange County Department of Social, you work with them, right, to address some of
these? Yes, the healthcare agency does the mental health services, but we provide the support for that. To talk about homelessness, this is how broken we were, not only in the state, but in the county. Nobody wanted to bring the resource together. The Sheriff's Department did it. We got the other police agencies now it's not a task force for enforcement, because I don't want to make it seem like going out and taking care of people who are less fortunate and don't have homes. But we had to start the strategy to start building the collaboration and the resources and bring people to the table. That's not our job. There should be other people forming those relationships and programs. But it was just stagnant. Nobody's moving the needle. And we came to the table and said, we're going to do these things because somebody's got to do something to deal with the issues of homelessness within Orange County. And now we have the Board of Supervisors is engaged, has been, but now more engaged because we've started the ball rolling forward. I don't think that would change anything if we hadn't come to the table and said, we're going to do something first, jump on the bandwagon with us, and let's create a strategy that does these things. But strategies are hard. If we have a culture of criminology and crime and don't hold people accountable, the old Drucker comment, culture eats strategy for breakfast. Without all these gaps, fill in the gaps, we aren't going to do anything to help keep the recidivism down, crime rate down. It's not going to go, it'll go the other direction. We just can't stop it.
Anyone else on collaboration? I've got a ton of questions here from folks in the audience, so maybe we should. And Drew, maybe this one is for you. So it says, with regard to Prop 57, I read that it would stop the arbitrary release of certain, quote, violent criminals. What does that mean?
So I don't know. I think.
And then, so there's a second part.
Okay.
Is the time credit part of Prop 57, is that like retroactive?
Yes. Okay, so on the first part, stopping the arbitrary release of violent offenders, I think that part of the campaign for Prop 57 was trying to suggest that in the absence of Prop 57, the state might violate the limit, and then the federal courts would order them to release people, and that the state wouldn't have control over that. It's not entirely clear that that's true because, I mean, the other alternative other than reducing the population is just to put more people in contract beds or build more prisons. Certainly an expensive response, but one the state has used to date. On the second part of the question about whether or not the effects of 57 are retroactive, in some sense they are the parole consideration parts. So if you're a nonviolent offender who's in prison today and you've already served your primary term, like I mentioned earlier, you are eligible for parole consideration immediately. So it is sort of retroactive for those folks. The credit portions will really depend on how it's implemented. I would expect that those wouldn't be retroactive, but it really depends on the regulations and how the administration implements it.
Just for clarification, that's not a nonviolent person. It's a person who's been incarcerated for a nonviolent crime. Those people can have criminal pasts that include violence. And they're eligible under this proposition.
Yeah, and it is important to note that while it's subject to some legal uncertainty, our office's assumption was that anybody who hasn't committed a crime that's on the list of violent crimes in the penal code would be eligible. And there are some crimes that aren't on that list that do are violent in nature. You know, if you were to talk to a layman on the street, like assault and that sort of thing. But legally in California, those aren't on the list, and so we would assume that those people would still be eligible.
So this is a broader question for everyone. So California has one of the highest incarceration rates in the world, and yet we also have a fairly high crime rate. So what's different about California that causes this?
That is not accurate. If you look at three strikes, and when we started incarceration, higher incarceration rates, there's a direct correlation between reductions in crime, reductions in violent crime, and incarceration of individuals. Conversely, if you switch that, start releasing people, we can assume that those people who are in custody that committed crime will commit crime while not in custody. So there is a direct correlation between reductions in crime over the last, since 1994, and the incarceration rate. You take the criminals off the street, they can't commit crime on the street. So there is a direct correlation between those two numbers.
Carol?
I think it's a little bit more complicated than that.
Yeah.
And I'd just like to raise a couple points about that incarcerated population. It's disproportionately minority. I mean, not only is it, do we have one of the highest incarceration rates in the country, and the United States has among the highest incarceration rates in the world.
It does.
Yes, it does. Higher than South Africa?
Yes.
So it's also a very racialized population, and it's largely made up of people from communities of color. There are also, there were questions that we got that we can't answer with regard to Prop 57 in particular or any of the propositions, but there's been a lot of work that's been done on the collateral consequences of incarceration for families and children. And that research shows that having an incarcerated parent, you might think of as being a protective effect. That is, it would protect the child from, because you're taking the problem, you're removing a problematic individual from the home. But when we look at these findings on a larger scale, what we find is that actually that in combination with the communities that individuals, that young people live in, has exactly the opposite effect. So that they're more likely to drop out of school, it's more likely to have an impact on health and well-being. So we're talking about a really significant problem that has consequences for the individual that's incarcerated, but also has consequences for the communities and their families and children. And we really need to think about whether this is the way in which we want to communicate to the world, and that this is the model that we want to represent the United States. It's an enormously complicated challenge, but we need to think about the ways in which we're going to develop models that are more that have a greater rehabilitative effects. If we also want to stop not just the impact on the individual, but the downstream consequences for children and families.
Bob?
Yeah, I think you're right. Look, these are exceptionally complicated, but the fundamental element of what America is about as a country is freedom. Freedom is based upon the individual, not based upon what you look like, your economic status, or whatever. That means that everybody should have an opportunity in a system to be treated in a way that is fair. And what happens is, and whether this is works exactly or not, look, what I was trying to explain in my opening is how, as a result of being around government for over 40 years, things go through pendulums, and you try things, and you course correct, and you try to figure them out. The issue of public safety, of course, is critically important, but we see the dual diagnosis problem and all these other challenges. And what I think we're trying to get to on all of these reforms, 109, 36, all of these things, is trying to determine of how to treat people as individuals and assess them through proper hearings. You know, I'm dealing with situations that I had these traffic ticket things I did for the last 2 years. We had people that had a broken taillight that ultimately got thousands of dollars in fines, lost their licenses, drove without a license, and find themselves in jail with $8,000 worth of penalties because they had a broken taillight. I mean, come on, guys. What kind of society do we want? We certainly want to put violent people away. We want people that are offenders to make sure that they pay their debt to society. But at the same time, we want a country that bases itself on the individual. And I think that that's what we're really grappling with here and in trying to figure out those systems in relationship to all the other things, how to feed a kid to go to school, make sure they can see the chalkboard, they have glasses, and all of the other elements that allow people to have a meaningful life.
Did you have anything on that, Drew? I have two more questions. One I'm going to read because it was a similar question to last time, but it makes the point, without behavior modification, nothing discussed here today will change. And the questions are, has the state's prison system looked into and implemented the prison fellowship program? Whoever asked the question, come and see me. I don't know, but I'll find out for you. And if not, why? And at the local level, has Celebrate Recovery been looked into to assist with behavior modifications and mental health issues? So I just wanted to raise those because, I mean, we've all heard today that part of the issue here is addiction and mental health issues.
That was one of the largest consequences of determinant sentencing was that there was nothing to entice people into programmatic shifts within the state prison system. So I will tell you that I think we're on agreement. We all want the same thing, but we have to look at the harms that are creating while we're doing this. So I think that when you talk about freedoms, I say that probably the greatest freedom we want is the freedom not to be victims of crime.
That's right.
And to be safe in our communities. And there's a cost that goes with that. But that these extremes of taking somebody's freedom from them and incarcerating them and holding them accountable has been a shift. Incarceration rates are high. Crime rates were historically low. But is it at the expense of civil liberties of individuals while putting them there? And that's really the greatest question we have to
Great
ask.
Question.
is there a fairness in doing this? But in between that, there's a gap of services that just do not exist. So Celebrate Recovery, all these different programmatic shifts that we can get people into, and hopefully so that they never come back, because that is our common goal, not to bring them back into a custody environment. That's the gap that's just not there today. And I don't know how we bridge that, because those have costs. But a lot of these savings, I'd much rather take these savings that are being referred to and build them into programmatic programs aimed at reducing the incarceration rates, focused on these communities that we're not creating the next generation of criminals, go in there, big brother programs, these things that will break that cycle of criminology that exists within some of these disparate and socioeconomically challenged communities, that will then keep the numbers down the right way, not by just re-releasing people into our society.
Just to add on to that, I think a lot of the intent behind Prop 57 is to try to get inmates to have an incentive to participate in rehab programs, and on the juvenile side, to keep youth in the juvenile system, which historically has had greater access to rehabilitation. Right. So the key question that we have is, are we offering a sufficient number of programs, and are the programs that we're offering effective? And I think we're looking into that now as an office, and CDCR hasn't done a lot of work in evaluating how effective its programs are. And so I think that's really going to be key, is to make sure that we evaluate the programs, we, you know, add on to the ones that have been shown to be effective, and that we restructure the ones that don't meet that mark. Because one of the unique things about criminal justice is there's pretty wide agreement in the research about what works. It's just a matter of implementing it correctly. And that's really what we need to look to CDCR
for. It's interesting that you say that. When I travel around and visit prison libraries, I mean, every single warden talks about how the possibility that if you behave well, if you get into a job training program, that kind of thing, the ability to actually get out, right, has reduced kind of the pressure cooker to some extent environment that used to be in the prisons. And I'm wondering if, as you say, if some of the intent anyway, I don't know what the result will be, but the intent of 57 is to sort of amplify on that condition.
Yeah, I think it's fair to say that really is what the intent is. It's just a matter of making sure that the programs are actually there to fulfill that intent, and that the programs that are there are operated effectively.
Yeah. Well, sorry, Carol, did you want to?
Well, I was just going to add.
We're getting close
to the end. Since we're all lining up at the trough to ask for money, just to remind you, the people in the audience and the legislators that are here. AB 109 was passed. Joan Peter-Cilley has described it as the largest experiment in prison downsizing in American history, and there was no money set aside to evaluate it. We have a series of experiments that we've been talking about, all of which we want answers for. Do they work or do they not? It takes time and it costs money to answer those questions, and repeatedly, the money is not set aside by the legislature to, in fact, answer those questions. So it's really hard to have evidence-based strategies when you don't have the rigorous social science research and time that's required to investigate. And I'll just make one other point. And I don't work with these data, but it's a plea for my colleagues. CDCR, it makes it very difficult to get data. So, you know, there's a lot of criminologists in the state of California and around the country that would love to be able to analyze these, but it's a public agency, it's public data, the taxpayers pay for this, and it's really hard to get these data.
When I was a reporter, it was a punchline, right, about how hard it was to get information out.
It's impossible to get. So, you know, if we want these answers, you know, CDCR works for the taxpayers, not the other way around, and we should be able to get the data.
Well, I was just going to finish. I'm sorry, were you? I was just going to finish, but
I was going to mention that the data sets are very problematic. When Prop 47 passed, Cal State Sheriffs, I was on a subcommittee with Cal State Sheriffs to study Prop 47, and I made the prediction before we started, you can't get 58 counties to get data that looks the same. It's just too difficult. Plus, the populations are significantly different throughout the state. We looked at it from the county, even within county municipal agencies, we couldn't get the data mining, the data to look the same. And so we have started with UCI. We're doing an analysis. We've given it to them. We have the data push. We're looking at South Orange County as a population. It has roughly 700,000 residents to look at Prop 47 in that group as a sample of the population, although there are economic differences between Orange County and other areas of the state. But just to do a pre-post, was there some indicators that Prop 47 had an impact? And they have the data, they're analyzing it, they're third party, the data's the data. We provided it, you tell us what it means. So maybe the first, one of the first at least, comprehensive studies of Prop 47 within a population. I will say the one thing, you talk about data analysis, in Prop 47, AB 109, the control group and all these things are you. This is a social science experiment being done in the populations in which we live. So you know, we are the control group that's being analyzed in this going forward. I don't like to be used as an analysis in crime in real time, and that's a little problematic for me to think that these things impact real people. There are victims, and the problems that we're doing, the structure we put in place, oftentimes re-victimizes the victims through this, through a process that fails them, and that's unsatisfactory.
Can I add something on the data? Because I think your points, the points okay. with respect to the data is very important. When I was on the board of the Public Policy Institute of California, we all the time were trying to gather data from these various jurisdictions, and some of the stuff's impossible to read, to understand. It's not in machine-readable code. And so before I came back into government, I spent a lot of time with Code for America and other technical folks, and I introduced a bill that Jerry signed whatever it was, a year ago, a year and a half ago, that requires all 4,848 subdivisions of government to at least tell us what systems they're operating. It's very difficult because, you know, this whole issue of local governments, remember we did this bellyaching about don't tell us what to do, but what we're trying to do is exactly that, so we can gather the data so that researchers, others can look at it, and outside folks can then, you know, rather than government folks always pre-screening stuff and telling you what the data says, you can have the data and then you have a bunch of smart minds look at it and gather the information and read things and often. So it's a first step. It's gigantically impossible. I'm working right now and trying to take a next step on this whole idea of machine-readable data so that all this stuff can be shared and the great minds can really find stuff that otherwise we don't see.
The other thing, we are moving to a different system just for the public. UCR is the FBI's UCR Uniform Crime Report. It's been used for decades. We're moving now because of issues we've had in analyzing data to the NIBRS, National Incident-Based Reporting System, which captures all crime, well, all reported crime, I should say. So there's some flaws in it because some crimes just go unreported. Sexual assaults are one out of three don't get reported because of the stigma associated with being the victim of a sexual assault crime. So when we look at Prop 47 outcomes, we'll be able to use all those Prop 47 related crimes in the data analysis. Yeah. Can't go back, but at least we can go forward in doing that.
So we're running out of time, but here's a final question. Point A, says the questioner, these two propositions were passed by the voters of California. Point B, says the questioner, why weren't things like this passed by the legislature? And point C is, is this a preview of criminal sentencing by proposition, which I might change around saying, is this the best way to come up with public policy in which the state of California is the control group?
No.
Okay, well, good. We should probably end there, actually.
I think that
we are actually seriously almost out of time, but go ahead. Yeah.
You know, we have to ask ourselves one simple question in everything we do. What are we hoping to accomplish here? And that should be the ends, and then we develop the means to get there. So if you look at what we're hoping to accomplish here, I'd say we go back to from public safety, make the public safe or safer. And I'm not sure that we're now accomplishing what we had hoped to do before. We still have great peace officers showing up, doing a phenomenal job every day in very, very tough environment. So if there's one thing I would ask for the group, you leave here today, if you see somebody in uniform, public safety, your thanks goes a long way for them doing the job. Thank them for the job they do. It's very encouraging for them to get that level of public support.
Thanks for doing the job.
Well, thanks. Thank our panel.
For one today.
Stay right there for a second. Senator?
Let's also thank our moderator, Greg Lucas. Thank you, Greg.
and thank our panelists, both A and B. Thank you for coming out. One more round of applause for our panelists. I also want to thank you, the attenders, for coming today to listen to this important topic. I want to thank the viewers that are watching online. I want to thank the Association of California Cities, Orange County, for their assistance. And I want to thank UCI for hosting as well. And I want to thank my staff for all their hard work putting this together. I think the last question sort of capped it, and that was, why are we at local government levels, cities and counties, being dictated on how we do public safety through ballot measures and propositions? And I had the privilege of serving with the Under Sheriff Don Barnes over the last 8 years, seven of them, I think, on where I was chairman of the Orange County Criminal Justice Coordinating Committee. And that was quite an education. But what I found out is when we hired someone new from out of Orange County and they came on the committee, they marveled at how collaborative things were in Orange County, how the DA, the sheriff, the probation chief, the presiding judge, we were all together working on issues, and how we always had Prop 63 and Prop 36, mm-hmm. Drug treatment versus jail. We discussed that every month on how are these programs working that have been implemented. And so I'm honored to have former Senator Bob Huff here today with his wife, May May. Thank you for coming. Bob swore me into the state Senate last year, so I thank you, I think. And it is an honor to have Senator Hertzberg, who could take a morning to come down from Van Nuys to be with us. So, Senator, we have a lot. Well, yeah, let's give him a hand. We have a lot to digest. This was a lot of good information. And we're all trying to figure it out. So I was chairman of the board in 2012, and I get a call. Would I come to the California Club up in L.A., and would I meet with former governors Duke Majan, Wilson, and Davis? And they invited the chairs of all the local boards of supervisors, and they said, our topic today is AB 109. We want to know what's happening in your counties. And so it was quite interesting to have Zeb give his perspectives. We had Brad Betzenfeld from San Bernardino share that crime was up, personal crime, property crime up 30%. We had Supervisor Horn from San Diego start listing the names of every woman that was murdered in his district since AB 109 was implemented by someone who was formerly an inmate. And it was a very dramatic time to discuss these things. So we've got a lot of work to do. And it's great that we can be collaborative as members of both sides of the aisle to try and get something accomplished. And we've gotten things accomplished. And you're working on bail. Last year we worked on just trying to get psychiatric beds in Orange County for mentally ill individuals that encounter police officers. And we only have 10 beds in Orange County. And police officers become transporters. You know, as they're trying to find an emergency room where to put somebody. So
not in the jail, in the private sector.
And you've got an incredible, I tell everybody all the time, we've got the largest mentally ill hospital in Orange County. It's our central jail. So we also work on Laura's Law together. Mm-hmm. And so we got that implemented in Orange County. And now so many counties have followed suit. And Daryl Steinberg allowed us to help with 1273, which I just want to thank you publicly, Bob, because you were a co-author. And I just thank you for helping. What happened is the Department of Healthcare Services went ahead and issued the regulations. So now we can offer and use Mental Health Services Act funding for this. So I want to tell you that the legislature is working on things. So we're not, not doing anything. We're listening and we're trying to implement ideas. And I think with Prop 47, you have someone by the name of Wayne Hughes who has a sincere desire to try and address recidivism. And he comes from the Chuck Colson model. And maybe that works in some areas, but when you do the experiment in society as a whole, in a state as big as California, it's not gonna be digested as it was planned. And so now we have to figure out how do we try to get to the goal that under Sheriff Barnes, you know, we're all trying to make sure we reduce the crime. How do we work on filling gaps? And so you're going to have to give us some ideas, and you're going to have to tell us what we can do. With regards to data, one of the most amazing things I found in Sacramento is that we don't have a CEO. Orange County has a CEO. Cities have city managers. And when you're not getting data, you go to your CEO and say, hey, your department isn't doing what it's supposed to be doing to get us data. So we got to figure out how to kind of encourage people in Sacramento to, these departments just seem like, as we used the term earlier, silos. So we got to see how we can do that. So something's happening, and let's hope that we can provide some solutions to address that here in the state of California. So thank you for coming, and have a great day.
Sandy, how's she doing?
Thank you, my handsome friend. This is great.
Thanks for being on our side.
Thank you. I was supposed to be in Cambodia. Instead, I'm in Orange County.
It's good to work with you again.